Good evening. I'm Nick Keppel. I'm the judge of probate for the Southeastern Connecticut Regional Probate District, which covers Stonington, Groton, Ledyard, and North Stonington. I'd like, on behalf of this series co-sponsors, I'd like to welcome you all here tonight and thank you for coming out. I'd like to take a moment to thank the co-sponsors, the Groton Public Library, who Betty Ann Ryder and her staff have done a wonderful job hosting this event. We thank them for their hospitality. My Southeastern court, yes, kudos to the library, committed to lifelong learning. Our court, the court is a co-sponsor as well, along with the Estate and Tax Planning Council of Eastern Connecticut, who I'll talk a little bit more about in a minute, and the Community Foundation of Eastern Connecticut. Those organizations have joined together to bring this lifelong learning opportunity to you. This is the third four-part series we've been conducting. We began in Stonington, went to North Stonington. Now we're here at the Groton Public Library. We're going next to the Mystic Nohank Library, then to Ledyard, and we hope, it's not official yet, but we hope to go to the Bill Library in Groton City next year as well. I'd like to give a quick shout out to our friend and colleague and community, devoted community servant, Dave Hammerstrom, who's being feted tonight over at the Seaport after several decades of community service and work for Chelsea Groton Bank. We couldn't be there to honor him tonight, but he's had an extraordinary career both in the banking world and as a model of community service, so we commend him and wish him best in his retirement. This series is intended to introduce people to critical issues in estate planning and the probate court. Our first session a few weeks ago was an introduction to how the probate court operates. So the good news for you is I was kind of one of the principal presenters last time, but I won't be tonight, so you'll be spared a lot of remarks from me. I'm essentially just moderating tonight. But Sean advises me the tape of it, of this last, the first session on the probate court is online and is going to be aired. And so I'm expecting a call from Steven Spielberg any time to launch my Hollywood career. And if he calls, by the way, I'm gone. I'm just, you can be assured of that. Quick word about since some of you may not have had a chance to join us last time, there's wonderful material in the packet about the probate court and particularly about decedents' estates. I just want to say a super quick word about what the probate court does. Because there's a lot of misunderstanding and lack of awareness. Essentially, the court deals with people passing away, death and its consequences, parenting, and capacity, people's capacity to manage their affairs. And the way the court deals with that is about half our docket is decedents' estates, the probating of wills, or where someone doesn't have a will, the probating of their estate. Also, though, conservatorships, where the court is petitioned to name a conservator of the person in a state, or someone, there's a question about whether someone has the capacity to manage their own affairs. We do guardianships for adults who don't have the capacity to manage their affairs. Typically, a parent comes in and when a child turns 18 and needs to be named guardian for their adult child. We also have a regional children's court in New London three different courts send our children's matters to there, so I sit once a week in New London in a court dedicated just to children's matters, where we deal with termination of parental rights, custody issues, and also temporary guardianships, as well as adoptions, one of my most fun activities. So the court deals with a wider range of issues than people realize, and there's a sheet in the pamphlet that has a website for the Connecticut Probate Court Office of Administration that has a tremendous amount of information, lots of material that can be downloaded, the annual reports, but also what the duties of a conservator, the duties of an executor. So lots of all the forms that you might ever need to function in probate. So I would heartily commend the probate court website. It's been a lot of time has been spent over the last couple of years to modernize and make the website as easy as possible for users. We are very pleased and we're grateful to have two tremendously talented and knowledgeable speakers with us tonight. Their curriculum vitae, their resumes are in your packet, so I won't go into great detail, but our first speaker on tonight's topics, which is wills, the building blocks of estate planning, wills, living wills, and powers of attorney. And our first speaker will be Neil Bobroff, an experienced attorney who's based in Mystic, who not only got his law degree from the University of Connecticut, but a master's degree in taxation from Boston University Law School. And Jack Reardon received his law degree from Suffolk University, and then his master's degree in elder law and estate planning from Western New England School of Law. So both not only went to law school, but then received advanced degrees in elder law issues. So we're very fortunate to have them join us tonight. Speaking of their participation, these are but two of a group of terrific, knowledgeable, dedicated presenters that we've had at this series. And before the last session, it didn't occur to me until this series to tally up the total contribution of effort that was being made by all of our presenters. And by my rough calculation, since we hope to have about 24 different sessions across six libraries, when you figure that many of the sessions we have three or four speakers, long and short of it is, across 24 sessions with three or four speakers times about 4 hours of preparation for each session, because it's roughly a two-hour session plus a couple of hours of preparation in planning meetings and preparation for their remarks, times, you know, conservatively $250 an hour. It ends up being the better part of a $100,000 contribution of time that's being made by a collection of speakers committed to informing the public. So I commend the Estate and Tax Planning Council, who has been the recruiter of these panelists for coordinating that effort and providing the speakers. And I commend all the speakers, including tonight's speakers, for giving of their time. Couple quick comments by me about wills and living wills and powers of attorney. I'll comment about living wills and powers of attorney a little bit later on after people's remarks. But essentially my message is, if you haven't done a will or living will or power of attorney, you really need to get on with it. Because if you don't, then the consequence of that is, especially for the will, is that you die what's called intestate, meaning, you know, when you give testimony, you're the speaker. We call in the world of estate planning and probate, someone who speaks through their will is called the testator. They're giving testimony about their wishes. And if you don't employ these planning instruments that are going to be described tonight, you will be considered to have not spoken. And that's where the word intestate, not having been a testator, not having spoken, comes from. And when you don't speak through these planning instruments, the state legislature decides for you what's going to happen with your assets. So it's not a great, as you can imagine, not a great alternative. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Attorney Bobroff, who's going to be our first speaker on the subject of wills. Thank you so much.
Thank you all, and I want to commend you all for coming out on a very beautiful Tuesday night in the fall. But I think it shows that you're all interested in the topic, and it's a very important subject. why people don't get their wills done is something that we all wonder about. I know it's partially because there are a lot of difficult decisions that sometimes have to be made. Which child are you going to pick for executor? If you have minor children, who's going to care for them if both you and your spouse pass away? And those can be very difficult. But I kind of also think that part of it is some superstition that if you actually do a will, you're more likely to die and use it. And I don't think that's a correlation. I'll assure you that I have a will, and my wife has a will. And I only bring that up from the old children's nursery rhyme, cobbler's wife who had no shoes, and the cobbler just never got around to it. But I got around to doing a will for myself and my wife because it is that important. Before I start in the wills, while everybody's fresh and attentive, I want to talk just about a very important concept that I, after I've greeted my clients, I always start with because it's really critical to understanding how property passes at one's death. And that is the concept of title and beneficiary designations and what does and does not pass under a will and through probate. Because a lot of people are under the impression that a will covers everything, and once you've said in your will that you want your property to go to John or to Mary, that that's going to work. Well, that's only true if the property is in your name, the testator's name, solely without a prior beneficiary designation. So if I have an enforceable contract with an insurance company or a 401k company, and I say, I want my life insurance and my 401k to go to Mary, it doesn't, that's what's going to control. It's a legally enforceable contract. If I decide in my will to say, I've changed my mind, I'm going to have Paul be the beneficiary of my 401k and my life insurance, well, that's going to be ineffective because the 401k company and the life insurance company have a legal obligation under contract to pay it to who I wrote in the beneficiary. So if you change your will or name someone in your will, you have to line it up with your other beneficiary designation property to make sure it all carries out your intent. And the same thing is with property that you don't own solely. If you own it jointly with rights of survivorship, like a joint bank account or a real estate jointly with rights of survivorship, that's going to pass automatically to the survivor no matter what you say in your will. So it's very important to know how you title things. And sometimes people put a unintended wrench into their estate plans by doing something without consulting an attorney as to the consequence. And I think the most common thing that we find happens is that the will says, I want to leave everything to all three children, one of whom lives locally. The parent gets a little older, isn't quite sure about their ability to pay the bills, so they add one of the local child to the bank account. And intending that all three children are going to receive that bank account because that's what the will says. But because they've added the child to the bank account, that's who's going to get the bank account, and it will be either a long, costly legal battle in the probate court to try to overturn that, or you're relying on the good graces of the child who got added to the bank account to share with their siblings, as was their parents' intent. So that's just a concept that's really important to understand, is title and how things are owned and whether your property will pass under your will or not. So frequently we'll have a husband and wife on, say, their primary residence, jointly with rights of survivorship, so that on the death of the first one, the house will pass automatically to the survivor. There still will have to be some probate court involvement to clear title. Obviously, we don't know which spouse is going to pass away first, so we want to make sure that both spouses have a will because we don't have a crystal ball and we just can't know certain things. So now I'll go back to the outline, having told you all about the importance of title. And Judge Keppel already mentioned one of the reasons why you want a will is what happens if you don't have it. And Attorney Reardon put in page 2, you'll see this Connecticut intestate distribution. So this is what happens. It's a flow chart as to what will happen if you don't have a will and how your property will will pass. And again, this is written by the legislature, by politicians, and they are sitting there trying to come up with every different scenario, which is why this flowchart seems a little bit complicated, but I'll just take you through one aspect of it. And the flowchart has to take into consideration, okay, what happens if someone dies with their spouse and the children are children of both parents? And what happens, conversely, if the parent dies, survived by another, by their spouse, but there are children from both spouses, and how does that work? So one of the examples I really like to use as to why, in my opinion, you wouldn't want the legislature writing your will for you by not having one yourself, is if I die with two children, both children of me, my spouse and myself, what does the legislature say happens? And this is just, and let's just say my spouse didn't have any property in her name, everything was just in my name. Well, in that event, if I died with children, my spouse would get the first $100,000. And she would have to split 50-50 with our children the rest of our property over and above $100,000. And I haven't met any spouse yet who wants that as a result. And again, you can see all the different possibilities in this rather complicated chart. And again, it's complicated because there are so many different situations. But I'm sure you can find other things that you would not like to have happen, including if you look at the very lower right-hand corner, what happens if, as a failsafe, if there are no beneficiaries available to receive your property and you didn't have a will, there's a potential the state of Connecticut would be the ultimate beneficiary. And most people, I hope, are charitably minded any way, but I would assume they would rather have money go to a charity or their best friends or neighbors or someone, but anybody but the state of Connecticut. And I say that having grown up in Connecticut and be feeling we're very lucky to be where we live. So in terms of doing your will, I'd say, you know, any will is better than no will, but that may not always be the case, as we will see. And one of the things I will talk about is the danger of doing it yourself. But I want to just sort of summarize again the reasons why it's really important to have the will, because you get to choose the executor. And I find a lot of times these words are familiar to all of us because we practice in this area. And so I'll try to my best to explain all of them. The executor is the person that you name in your will to execute your will, to carry out your terms. It's a fiduciary responsibility. They can't just take your property and do what they want with it. They have to follow your words and your will and carry those out. Collect all your property, make sure all your debts and any taxes and fees are paid, and then just make the distributions of your estate as you yourself, after much contemplation, decided to have your property pass. Again, having a will allows you to pass property on to charity or friends. A frequent reason that you want to have a will is that your children might not be mature enough to handle money. Now, certainly if they're under 18, they're not legally able to have any money in their own name over a certain amount without the probate court's supervision. You're a legal adult in Connecticut when you're the age of 18. And so most parents who've had teenagers almost universally agree that 18 is too young to receive an inheritance, because rather than pay for education, a fast car seems like a really fine choice for an 18-year-old. And you may not want to leave your property to them till 25 or 30, or if you're older and you have a 35-year-old child, you may decide that 45 might be the age that they finally reach maturity and can handle money. Or you may decide that they need a professional trustee and they should never have total control over their money because they're just not capable. And, you know, we see all types of people in our practice and all types of families. And part of what we do is analyze the situation and talk to our clients about it and decide what's really the appropriate thing for you and your family. So rarely are two wills alike, and the forms you buy from a stationery store really, you know, don't give you any advice as to how to handle your personal situation. It's a somewhat rarely known fact that wills can actually save you money, because if you don't have a will, the probate court will usually is required to make you go out and your executor, and without a will it's called an administrator, but the job is basically the same. Your administrator would have to go to an insurance company and buy a bond to make sure you weren't going to go run away with all the property of the decedent. So by waiving that requirement, if you have a trusted executor, you're actually saving your estate a significant amount of money. You can also specify what authority you want to give to your executor. Sometimes that's very important, especially with small business owners, I find, that you want to give the executor the chance to either continue to operate the business for the children to take over one day or to wind it down, and it's very useful, again, when we find clients in specific situations to tailor those fiduciary powers. Having the will, again, will promote harmony in the family. There is such a great potential for family disputes when you don't have anything in writing as to how you want your property to go. And you just really, you know, maintain control over where things are going to end up, and you give it your best shot to make sure that it's going to be the best shot for family peace, and the children are going to continue to get along for the rest of their lives and not be embittered by a very contentious estate settlement process. I'll talk a little bit about the dangers of do-it-yourself forms, and one of the big things I find is that it's very, forms make it very amenable to poor planning. And the example I like to use is that I have four children. I'll call them John, Paul, George, and Ringo. And I write in my will, doing it yourself, not having gone to law school, I want to leave $25,000 to John, Paul, George, and Ringo. And I don't know if anybody sees an obvious problem with that, but then when we get to the estate settlement process, when we're no longer able to ask the decedent for clarification, it might occur to somebody to ask, did they mean that the four of them are supposed to split $25,000, or are they supposed to get $25,000 each? So again, we've gone to school to try to make sure these type of misunderstandings don't happen. Another big problem with doing it yourself is improper execution. There are very specific instructions as to how to execute a will in front of two witnesses in Connecticut, and if they're not followed, you've put in a lot of work on a piece of paper that's not a will and has no legal effect, and you're back in the intestacy statute with having the legislature choose what happens with your property. As part of that execution process, what we do is a self-proving affidavit. And what this means is that in order to prove a will, you need to have shown that there are two witnesses there who are supposed to testify in front of the probate court that the person who signed the will was of sound mind and memory and declared it to be their will, and there was no reason that there was suspicion that they weren't fully capable. And the reason we do that and take the oaths of the witnesses as part of the will execution process is that is all the evidence that is needed to establish that the will was validly executed. So you don't have to go searching 30 years after the will was signed for these witnesses to come to probate court and testify in front of the probate judge. Now, in certain cases, there may be a dispute, and the witnesses may have to be found and testify, but I would say at least 99 out of 100 cases that wouldn't be the case. So it really makes things much more convenient and for everybody. And the final big reason I would say for not trying to do it yourself is, again, people need advice. And what I told you at the beginning about the property passing under the will or not under the will, and depending how it's titled, you know, no stationery store or the website is usually going to give you advice as to what's going to happen. I'll talk a little bit about the requirements of making a will. Basically, anybody 18 years old or older can make a will. They just have to be of sound mind, and there's a lot of case law in Connecticut as to what constitutes capacity. So basically, they have to know who their family is, who their natural objects of their bounty, and they can't be under any undue influence either. Undue influence is typically something where someone's putting a lot of pressure on someone to make a will, usually someone who's incapacitated. But the classic case that sometimes ends up in the probate court or sometimes the criminal court is there's an elderly person and they're being taken care of by this nice caretaker that none of the family ever knew before, and how they got hired is kind of a mystery, and they managed to block out the children from seeing the parent, and all of a sudden the parent dies, and the will happens to name this caretaker as beneficiary of the will to the exclusion of the children. So that can tend to be a classic case of undue influence. But most of the time we don't see that, and it's pretty clear whether someone has capacity or not. Now, we always like to encourage people like to go out and do their wills soon and not wait till the last minute, but it is possible that you could be in a hospital or a nursing home and still have mental capacity to sign a will, and so we don't like to do it. It causes all sorts of difficulties, but we can go to nursing homes and hospitals and prepare wills and execute them. But it adds a whole lot of extra expense as well as complexity to wait that long, so it's a much better idea to be motivated to do it soon. There's some other miscellaneous information I want to go into about wills. There's certain protections against spouses. So a spouse who is disinherited can elect against the will, and they get what's called a statutory share, which is life use and 1/3 of the property. But in Connecticut, that only applies to the probate property. So we don't like to deal with situations where one spouse is trying to cut out another in the will. So usually there's a very good reason for it. Wills, once they are signed, are good for the rest of your life unless you revoke them or prepare a new one that revokes the old one. Wills can be revoked by tearing it, burning it, a whole bunch of ways, or commonly revoke preparing a new one. And wills don't need to legally be updated. However, what we usually tell clients is that maybe every 5 to 7 years, take a look at it, see if it still carries out your wishes, and ask yourself, have your circumstances changed? Did that child that you were going to let inherit it 22 suddenly have a lot of creditors, and maybe you want to set up some sort of trust to protect them against their own bad circumstances? And again, there are certain circumstances that will change which will make you do another will. For instance, if you get divorced or married, you're going to need to do a will. The final thing I put about under my miscellaneous category, because I get asked this a lot when I'm drafting wills, is there any such thing as will readings? And I've never been to a will reading, and I presume nobody. As far as I know, it's a Hollywood creation where everybody sits around the table and the will is read so that the person who's left out of the will can have to be surrounded by the people who are saying, see, you should have treated Dad better. But we do, however, now the probate rules all changed July 1st, and we do send copies of the will by mail or email to all the heirs of law, so they have a chance to dispute the will or claim against it or accept it and say everything looks like they want it to go forward as quickly as possible, which again is most of the cases, but we never know who walks through the door, what their circumstances are going to be. So with that being said, I think I've concluded my portion about wills, and I'll turn it over back to the judge.
Thank you, Neil. Without further ado, I'll introduce Attorney Reardon, who's going to talk about powers of attorney and living wills.
Thank you, Judge Keppel. Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming out tonight. We you've just heard about the importance of having a will to plan for the disposition of your assets following your passing. But a good estate plan should also deal with possible incapacity during your lifetime. And the staple documents that help you deal with that include a power of attorney, an appointment of a health care representative, and an advance directive, which is also commonly referred to as a living will. And I'll address each of those today, and I'll start with the power of attorney. Now, a power of attorney is an important document that authorizes somebody to conduct your business affairs for you. Now, it creates an agency relationship between you and the person that you nominate. The legal term for that person is an attorney in fact, but I'll just refer to them as an agent for ease of conversation. Now, why would you want to have a power of attorney in place? If you don't have a power of attorney in place and you become incapacitated either because you're in an accident and you can't communicate anymore, or you are bedridden, or if you have a mental incapacity and you are suffering from an illness or something that prevents you from thinking clearly, if you don't have a power of attorney in place, the alternative is going to probate court and asking for the appointment of a conservator. Now, that is going to involve the expense of filing a petition, hiring somebody to prepare the paperwork for you, and ongoing court oversight of that proceeding. The person who is appointed the conservator will need to have the authority of the court to handle your affairs. Now, if you were to just prepare a durable power of attorney, that document would do away with the need for going to court and getting a conservator appointed. And what do I mean by a durable power of attorney? A durable has nothing to do with the type of paper it's printed on. It's not strong paper. It means that the document still exists following your incapacity. Under common law, the power of attorney agency relationship terminates upon your incapacity. But by statute in most states, including Connecticut, if you include language in the document saying that it survives your subsequent incapacity, then that document is considered a durable power of attorney, and it will not be affected by your disability. Now, in order to create a power of attorney, it must be executed with the same formalities as is required for a deed. So it needs to be in writing. It needs to be signed by the principal, that's the person who is granting the power of attorney, and it needs to be witnessed. Now, a power of attorney is revocable at any time as long as you still have the mental capacity to do so. There are two types of power of attorney. One is called a springing power of attorney, and the other is an immediate power of attorney. Now, the difference between the two is that a springing power of attorney only comes into effect upon your incapacity, whereas an immediate power of attorney, as soon as you sign that document, that person you authorize as your agent can immediately go out and start conducting business on your behalf. And in for most of my clients, I recommend that the immediate power of attorney should be used. The reason for that is a springing power of attorney creates an extra burden on the person you name as the agent. Each time they go to use it, they're going to have to prove that you are incapacitated and that the document is now in effect. In order to do that, they're going to have to get a recent letter from a doctor saying that you are incapacitated. Now, with a durable power, with an immediate power of attorney, that is not required. And I also recommend to my clients, I mentioned to them that if you're going to give somebody the authority to act as your agent, you should only be doing that if that person is somebody that you really trust. which is why you can give them an immediate power of attorney, because you trust that they will not go out and misuse it. Now, if you are ever concerned that they still might be tempted, there are ways of dealing with that, where you could place it in escrow with an attorney or a trusted advisor, and have them only give it to the agent when they deem that the need arises. And one important thing to note about a power of attorney is that the authority granted and it ends at the principal's death. So once the person who drafted that document passes on, it is no longer effective, and you should not, if you are named an agent, go out and attempt to use it. Now, in Connecticut, there are statutory forms of powers of attorney. There's a short form and a long form. And these documents can be found in the statutes. Now, some of these these statutes are fairly old, and most practitioners in the field of estate planning have added extensive revisions and additional powers to these documents that we've found through the years are necessary to make them suitable for use. Now, they incorporate what is known as the Fiduciary Powers Act, which grants a broad list of additional powers that are not written out or spelled out in the statutory documents. And one of the dangers of using the statutory form is that often people aren't aware of what powers that they've actually granted to their agent. So it is preferable, in my opinion, to have a tailored document where actually all the powers are spelled out within the instrument itself. Now, another document that is very important in estate planning is the appointment of a healthcare representative. Now, if you are ever incapacitated or unable to communicate with your physicians, this person can step into your shoes and make your medical decisions for you. Now, this also, again, avoids the necessity of going to court and asking for a conservator to be appointed to make medical decisions in case you are incapacitated. Now, the appointment of healthcare representative, it's also commonly referred to as a healthcare proxy. It only comes into effect if your doctor determines that you have, are unable to understand and appreciate what is happening to you and to communicate effectively with your doctor. Now, appointment of healthcare representative also must be in writing and must be declared before two witnesses. And in order to revoke a healthcare proxy, you must also do it in writing with two witnesses, with the same formality. Now, if you are ever appoint your spouse in a healthcare proxy and you subsequently get divorced or separated legally from that person, they are automatically revoked as your agent. In order to execute a healthcare proxy, you must be 18 years of age or older and of sound mind. Now, one reason you may prefer to have a healthcare proxy in place instead of relying on the state statutes, which determine who can make decisions for you, is so that you can determine who among a class of people will make your decisions. Now, if you you were in the hospital and your next of kin were your five siblings, they would all have equal say in what is being done. You may not want that to be the case. You may want to choose just one of those individuals to be your spokesperson and to make known your wishes. which is why it is important to have this type of document. Now, in conjunction with those two documents, I commonly talk to my clients about what is known as a designation of a conservator for future incapacity. Now, when we have these documents in place, we don't expect that we would ever need a conservator to be appointed. But if you have a document in writing designating who your conservator would be if somebody were to petition the court, the judge is going to follow your wishes as long as that person is deemed fit to be a conservator. Now, that can prevent somebody from who gets upset at who you've chosen as an agent from going to court and trying to get around your selection. Now, if you've named the person who is your agent in your power of attorney and your agent in your healthcare proxy as your conservator in the event of future incapacity, then you've essentially shielded them from somebody attempting to do this. Another document that is important is the advance directive. This is commonly called a living will. Many of you have probably heard of the Terry Schiavo case, where a woman was in a terminal condition for over 7 years and going through multiple court hearings, or at least her husband was, trying to allow her to die peacefully. Now, if she had had a living will expressing her own end-of-life wishes, this could have been prevented. Now, an advance directive is a document that you can tailor to whatever your desires are. Some people don't want to be kept alive if they're ever deemed to be in a vegetative state and have no meaningful hope of recovery. But I have had clients who have had the opposite opinion and want to be kept alive at all costs in hope of someday medical advances will be made to allow them to recover from their illness. But some of the other important reasons for having a living will are the fact that it helps your loved ones make this difficult decision if you are ever in the situation where you are in a coma and you have no meaningful hope of recovery. It is a difficult decision to make, and if you've already expressed this in writing, it does help them come to grips with that. And it can also help avoid family disputes if you have close loved ones who disagree on whether or not you should be kept alive at all costs. Now, a living will, unlike an appointment of a healthcare representative, can be revoked in any manner, either by orally or in writing, and regardless of your mental capacity at the time. And even though you may have a living will in place, the law does still require that you be provided comfort and pain alleviation if you are in such a state. Many people find that they want to be an organ donor if the time ever comes. And a document of an anatomical gift is a way of expressing your wishes if you do want to have your body donated to science or to an organ bank for use by others. Now, this is a document that should not be included in your will. And the reason for that is your will may not be read until it's too late. That's a document that you probably have in your home somewhere that has not been uncovered by the time this decision has been made. In line with that, all of these medical documents, the appointment of healthcare representative, the living will, and the document of anatomical gift are documents that you should provide to your healthcare provider once you've executed them. If you give these documents to your doctor, they're required to make them a part of your medical record, so that in the event something happens to you, your wishes will be known. Now, the final document I have here is the disposition of remains and appointment of agent. And again, this is a document you would want to be separate from your will. And this is mainly a document just to express your wishes with regard to burial or cremation. And many people don't want this document, but I do always bring it to their attention. I have had clients that we've represented who have gotten in disputes with siblings over what was going to be the final disposition of their parent. And if they had a document such as this in place, they could have avoided an expensive court proceeding to finally determine whether their parent would be buried or cremated. And again, something like this can also minimize disputes in your family. And a note on the last page, I have a note about HIPAA privacy authorization. Now, I'm sure most of you are familiar with HIPAA. It's the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act. It's a federal law that protects the privacy of your medical records. And many of these forms do involve authorizing people to make medical decisions for you, or even deal with medical facilities and paying your bills. So it is important to incorporate into these documents the proper language that allows your agents to access your medical records and information if necessary. And with that, Deal or Nick, do you have any comments?
I just wanted to mention a couple of things that occurred to me while you were speaking, and that was I wanted to agree with you about springing powers of attorney not being something that I would recommend in most cases, because it does make it more difficult, as you stated, for the agent to actually use it. And we do find that there are difficulties sometimes in getting powers of attorneys accepted, particularly by some of the big national banks or out-of-state banks, and we want to avoid that battle if we can. And when you put an extra level of difficulty by making the agent prove that the principal is disabled, that really can slow things down quite a bit. And in addition, Connecticut does have the statute which allows springing powers of attorney, but other states don't feel that way. And Florida specifically says that springing powers of attorney are not valid. So I think powers of attorney are a very useful document. I always talk to them, to my clients about them, as you do, and I think making it easier for them to use or for them to be used when the time arises is a good thing. The other thing I wanted to ask you about is the storage of all these documents, because we frequently get those questions. Where should you keep your will? Where should you keep your powers of attorney and healthcare documents? So I'll let you talk about that.
Yeah. Well, with some of these documents, such as your will, you can only have one original. Our practice is to scan and keep an image of the original and provide the keep that in our records, but provide the original back to the client, and we recommend that they keep it in a safe place, either in a fireproof box somewhere in the home, or preferably in a safe deposit box in a bank where it will be protected in the event of a fire in your home. An important addition to that is letting somebody know where it is and how to access that in the event the time comes. Now, with the other documents, the appointment of the healthcare reps, the living will and the power of attorney, you can execute multiple originals of those documents. And we usually recommend that our clients do that, and we keep at least one original in our file and provide them with multiple originals themselves. And we tell them to advise the people they've named as agents in those documents how to access those documents if they need them, and often they'll provide them to them in advance so that they have them already.
I have a couple comments.
Thank you very much, Jack. Couple quick comments. One on the disposition of remains. I wanted to share that even in my short tenure, I've been judge of probate for just over 2 years now, I actually had a disposition of remains dispute. I wasn't even sure, because in my private practice, I hadn't encountered a dispute. I wasn't aware that that was something that the probate judge even had to potentially decide on. So it does, my point is, disputes about the remains of the deceased person do arise. It happened in I haven't been there 20 or 30 years, I've only been there 2 years, and we've already had one dispute regarding disposition of remains. And to me, which by the way, I somewhat sternly, which is unusual for me, ushered the family, the two siblings who were had different views about the remains, out into the hall and directed them to resolve this, because I told them their parent would not have really wanted me to be making that decision. So I used a technique I learned from my wife to shame them into a reasonable resolution, and they did work it out, thankfully, because I didn't want to be making that decision, frankly. But it's a good illustration of why it's important for you. You're the best positioned to know whether you've got children who don't get along. And so if there's a potential that there's going to be a dispute, whether it's remains or anything else, then it's all the more important for you to share that with your planning professional, because you know better. Your planning professional needs to be informed by you about the peculiarities, to be kind, of your own situation, what your needs are, what your situation is. Only you have that information, and so that information is the foundation for a well-structured, personalized planning document. Two other quick things, and then we'll wrap up. On the value of naming a conservator and doing the power of attorney. Attorneys Boboff and Reardon were kind about the importance, but I can be more direct that, you know, if you can avoid having to come into my court to name a conservator, that's a really good thing. I think it's great that my court and our wonderful staff, which I also have to give a big shout out to, who I talked about last time, who do a fantastic job. My five clerks are just fantastic, and I'd be lost without them. But even though it's a service to the community to have the court have the capacity to name a conservator where no one's been named, so that someone who's impaired can be taken care of and their assets can be taken care of, if you can avoid having what is sometimes a controversy, because more often than not, someone who, or very often, someone who's impaired doesn't think they're impaired, and so it can be a controversy. It also, there's a cost associated with it. There's a cost for the proceeding. There's fees to apply. People sometimes often retain counsel, so because it can be disputed. So there's a litigation aspect or an adversarial process that can go on, which has a cost associated. Plus, if I name a conservator of the person or estate, particularly the estate, an inventory and accountings have to be done, the first one after a year, and then every 3 years thereafter. So if someone who gets impaired at a moderately young age, you can do multiple three-year accountings, and those take time and often money. So there are, you know, meaningful costs that are associated, both emotional and financial, with the establishment of a and the conduct of a conservatorship. So if it can be avoided with planning, then I heartily recommend that you do so. Because the first question I ask when an application comes in is there a power of attorney? Has there been a conservator identified? And if they have, then I respect the wishes of the person before they were impaired. And there is no need for a conservator. Lastly, quick comment. On the cost of doing all this, because I expect that maybe a point of curiosity for a couple of you, and it's a very difficult, you know, how much does all this cost is an exceedingly difficult question. It's sort of like saying, how much does a car cost? There's cars, clunkers for $200 and $500, $1,000, and then there's Maseratis and everything in between. So you can imagine that what this costs is very, very much a function of the scope of your assets and the complexity of your estate planning. I think we're blessed in this region to have financial planners and a county bar with loads of many people who have a great deal of expertise in estate planning and elder law, who are both very, very knowledgeable and also very nice people, as evidenced by their participation in this series. You know, I think as a rough, I don't know, I don't want to put our speakers here on the spot, but I mean, you can, I think, reasonably expect if you're going to do the full scope of the planning documents that Attorney Boboff and Reardon have discussed tonight, you know, you're talking about, you know, $1,500, $2,000for the simplest, on that order of magnitude. And again, That's a very modest, and if you have any kind of assets, and especially if you want to do any particular planning, I think you could easily spend, you know, significantly more than that. So I share that with you because you should shed any illusion that it's going to be, you know, some modest figure of a few hundred dollars, because if you do it right, and as has been described here, you anticipate the serious consequences that it's basically an investment in the proper distribution of your assets. And you've worked hard all your life to accrue those assets, and they should be distributed as you wish. And if you have to invest a little money in seeing to that it's done the way you want it done, I would submit to you it's money well spent. So I want to thank you all for coming, and we'll see you all hopefully on the October 29th when we talk about estate taxation and the use of trusts. Thank you so much.